Good afternoon, everyone. Welcome to the Milbank Forum. Today's topic is titled, panel is titled Litigation for Sale, and we will be talking about the patent system and the dreaded so-called patent trolls. We have a fantastic set of panelists here, and me, and the goal will be to get the conversation started. Given the complexity of the topic, it won't be so easy to break folks down into one side or the other, but I will nevertheless try to do so. I will make some very quick introductions and then talk a little bit about the topic and then make some very quick introductions. So why are we doing this forum? Well, if you are interested in intellectual property, you probably know about this issue. But if you are not, you should be interested in this issue. Item number one, Congressman Goodlatte, who is a very powerful member of the House of Representatives, he is chair of the House Judiciary Committee, has introduced a bill aimed at curbing so-called abusive patent assertion. It is titled the Innovation Act. And among other things, Congressman Goodlatte's bill, which has gotten pretty broad support on the Hill, both in the House and potentially in the Senate as well, is aimed at curbing the activities of so-called patent assertion entities, better known as patent trolls. These are people or entities that own patent claims that they do not themselves practice and then sue on those patent claims in court. We can talk about Congressman Goodlatte's bill a little bit later as we get into the discussion, but this is one of the main topics on Capitol Hill. If you are at all interested in the writings and the work of Richard Posner, you know that he has, in recent years, suddenly become the scourge of the patent system. On the view that many patents are in fact garbage patents and that much patent litigation is quite wasteful. This doesn't just occur in the Article III courts. We also have litigation in trade forums in order to block the importation of items into this country. If you paid attention at all to the debates about, is it Samsung's tablet in recent years, there was an attempt to go after Samsung and Apple fighting against each other in trade forums. Because the corners were curved. So this is a topic that has gotten lots of political attention, obviously has huge economic consequences, and actually has some intellectual interest as well that we will talk about. So the panel is a fantastic group of folks who know the field and have worked in this area for some time now and bring lots of knowledge and their views to bear. Starting on my far right is Roger Brooks. He is a partner in the litigation department of Cravath, Swaine, and Moore. He received his law degree from University of Virginia, and he has been a patent litigator for many years. And has litigated some of the biggest bet the company cases in recent years. Next to him is someone who needs no introduction. He is Richard Epstein, the Laurence Tisch Professor of Law here at NYU. Richard knows everything about everything. I was skeptical when he said he wanted to talk about patents. I said, Richard, I don't know anything about them, and you don't either. He quickly persuaded me, of course, that I was wrong, as he usually does, although this took less time than it usually does for you to persuade me that I'm wrong. Next to me on my left is John Potter. John is the president of the Application Developers Alliance, which is a trade organization that represents a variety of organizations. I will actually ask him a little later to talk about what the organization does. He is, most importantly, an alum of this law school who, as he told me at lunch today, was able to make a very good living running businesses out of his dorm room while he was a student here.
Legal businesses.
Legal businesses. Legal businesses, he says.
So I'm disappointed.
And which just goes to show you, if you think tuition was high now, you know, it was always high back then. And of course, on my far left is Jason Schultz, who teaches here. He is a he runs our technology, law, and policy clinic. Before coming to NYU, he was at Bolt Hall at Berkeley, where, and he was also a staff attorney at EFF, the Electronic Frontier Foundation, and practiced intellectual property law at the patent firm Fish and Richardson. So those are the dramatis personae. I will start out by making the following assertion and then asking the panelists to either agree or disagree with me. I'm someone who is generally skeptical of using procedural changes to fix underlying substantive law. Who cares who is asserting a patent claim? If the claim is valid, the claim is valid. If the claim is invalid, the claim is invalid. So why does it matter if a patent claim is being pursued by a so-called patent troll? Isn't the problem weaknesses in the underlying patent law regime? And if so, fix the regime. Don't bother going after trolls. They're not really doing anything wrong. Discuss.
Well, who do you want to discuss
first? Anybody discuss.
I'll take a crack at
okay.
Surprise. I think there's some truth to it, but not the entire truth to it. If you start looking at the way in which the world is organized in other substantive areas, it turns out that the size of the claim and the nature of the claim, it actually starts to matter. So if you're dealing with the patent troll issue and you have a small, struggling small business which is having trouble making ends meet, I'm being sued by a demand letter that contains no particular specifics. It gives terror. They don't have access to the system. There can be a lot of litigation or duress through litigation. You're dealing with struggles between large, major entities, all of which are relatively sophisticated. It may well be that the thing is the opposite. Or to put it another way, the simplest observation is you may need procedural remedies if the abuse comes in certain classes of cases and not others. And at that particular point, you have to look both at the substance and the procedure. The one point in which Troy is, of course, correct is if all patents were perfect in terms of the way they were issued, then none of these problems would exist. But there is this question of compensating error, and there's the further question, even if the remedy, the patent is valid, you can still be abusive with respect to the claim, with respect to the amount of damages that you're claiming.
So I'll add a couple of things to that. Patents are a funny kind of claim. Because if they're invalid...
I'm not laughing.
No. Funny in the sense that if it's invalid, it never should have existed in the first place, right? So it's not like some claims where there might be some moderation that happens through a litigation process or whatnot. It really comes back to a question of policy. And that's why I think this is different than a lot of other just sort of a claim as a claim. The reason we have these claims in the beginning is to promote the progress of the useful arts, right? That's what it says in the Constitution. And in this instance, it's doing the opposite in most cases, if not all cases, where it's anti-innovation, right? So if it's such a bad policy situation where the thing it's trying to do, you're actually getting the opposite effect, allowing the claims to just continue on and trying to fix the system kind of at one end or the other without actually getting to the underlying policy rationales, I think you don't really get the benefits that you're looking for. You don't get the fix you want. The claims shouldn't exist at all if they're invalid. And even if you were to fix the patent part, right, even if you were to get some sort of perfect patent system where only perfect patents came out, the leverage also comes in claims of whether you infringe or not. You could have a perfectly valid patent, but whether these small businesses, a lot of them startups, actually touch on the patent at all is a whole nother question. And the other thing about patent litigation, and I want to get into the specifics of it because I think it's important, is that there are certain kinds of claims that are just extraordinary, and this is a bit of what Richard was saying too, extraordinarily expensive to litigate, extraordinarily expensive. Like the recent studies and reports from the American Intellectual Property Legal Association sort of say that, you know, a moderate patent litigation will cost you $2.6 million in legal fees. That's a moderate one, right? And they can range up to $8, $10, $12 million, even higher. So I think part of the problem is that a claim is not just a claim when the expenses of defending if you're not infringing are so high.
Your question, I think, to summarize it a little more neatly was, do people and processes matter, or does substance matter?
Yes.
And I think people and processes matter a lot. Rogers at Cravath, people knock on your door for what I would consider, I spent 7 years at Weil Gotshal. They were actually good years in many ways. So I used to have some of these experiences, but Rogers much better, and Cravath is that kind of firm. People come to you for bet the company litigation. I assume they don't come to you for garden variety cases, because there's other garden variety firms that can handle garden variety cases. They're coming to you for big cases that are big value, and they're ready to write your check to win. And it's damned important that if they can't win, they're going to fight for long enough they can get a reasonable settlement out of this and a reasonable license and royalty. And before companies file those cases or send those assertion letters, they do homework. Right? And so I think people and process does matter. And so whether the plaintiff, the asserting party, is Monsanto versus Dow Chemical or something like that, or whether it's Intellectual Ventures versus AT&T, those are big parties, whether they're a patent assertion entity or an operating company. They're big companies doing big research, and they're coming to you and saying, we think you're infringing, and here's the volume of documentation that shows you that you're infringing, and we should have a discussion about this. And we think the infringement is worth X, and we can talk about how we calculated that, and that's going to be a very healthy discussion. And by the way, we already drafted the complaint. Yeah, whippy-doo, we're going to do the work anyway. We're going to do the infringement analysis anyway. We're going to do the invalidity analysis anyway. So whether you sue us or not, to have that discussion, we're going to do a lot of the work that we would otherwise do in court. Different people, different process matters. When it's my company out in Santa Barbara that gets a claim letter, literally four sentences long, from a company that you can't find anywhere, not even in Marshall, Texas, right? You can find there, and it is your website and your app are infringing on these three patents. These three patents that cover auto-scrolling technology. Here's my proof that you're infringing, and they literally put the URL for the guy's homepage. You gotta be effing kidding me. Three patents, 78 claims, they gotta go hire, I'm gonna say, a garden variety patent lawyer, right? Because they can't afford Roger. And so they have a garden variety patent. They're going to analyze 78 claims on auto-scrolling technology, and how many dozens of patents do you think there are, by the way, on auto-scrolling technology, and decide whether they're infringing or not. They can't countersue because it's an assertion entity. They can't cross-license to settle the matter because it's an assertion entity. The entity doesn't do anything except for sue people.
It can license, though, couldn't it?
It can license, and what does it do? It has a printing press. Remember the old Ditto machine, right? Oh, there's, they basically set up a spreadsheet, find out where you live, and they send you a claim letter, and they send hundreds and hundreds of these claim letters, and they know that a lot of people are going to say, fuck, the lawyer's going to cost me $40,000 just to do the initial analysis, and that's a cheap date in the patent world. I'll stroke you a check for $5,000. I'll stroke you a check for $10,000, and now you're a mark. It's like the grandmother who buys from the penny stock guy who calls up. That phone number gets passed around. So yes, process matters. People matter. Because that's the way that's the smash and grab troll business.
Okay, you've almost convinced me, not quite. Roger?
Yeah, I will say a couple of things. Process does matter, but process shouldn't be used in a pseudo-random way to address substantive problems with the system. I do see the high-end problems. My client probably makes more in licensing revenues than any other company in the world. One of my leading clients is Qualcomm. But they also sell more chips for cell phones than any other company in the world, and they're regularly targeted by, quote, trolls. And I just want to say right now, though, that nobody can define what a troll is.
A troll is someone who's suing you that you don't like.
Well,
that's everybody.
There is no bright line.
I might contest that later, but okay. Keep going.
And even though my client is regularly sued by patent assertion entities, to use a politer term, I want to admit that from the point of view of the little guy, I think those serve an important economic purpose. We believe in specialization. We believe in liquidity for assets in all sorts of markets. And the guy who is capable of inventing may have neither the know-how nor the resources to assert. Mm-hmm. And yet, right, he's done just what the patent system wanted him to do, which is invent. And, you know, a non-practicing entity is basically a bunch of capital designed to acquire these rights and assert them. That's an important part of a liquid market. So I don't want to deal with any of these issues by kind of just labels that are disparaging. And I don't want to say, well, if it's not performing well, let's just weaken the system by making it harder to assert or making the asset a non-transferable one. And yet, I also see companies coming in and saying, you know, I have this patent. Would you be interested in taking it on a contingency basis? And we look at it. And, you know, would you rule that out? No. But in many cases, when you look at the target, maybe it's worth a few million dollars, but it's not worth the cost of a whole litigation. You just can't economically do that. So at the high end, for my client that's selling billions of chips, you a steady drumbeat of trolls, but you know what? The cost of dealing with that compared to the volume of commerce you're talking about really isn't a crisis. It's just something you deal with. There's transaction costs. No system is perfect. But at the low end, you may, if the transaction costs, if you have, this is to your process point, if your process is what I think of as gold-plated, it's for really vigorous adjudication of validity, of infringement, of all these things, but it's too expensive to use. Well, that's a process problem where you've created transaction costs that render your asset unusable, render the incentive that we wanted non-existent for the small player because you're not going to be able to take it and cash it in. And that suggests that maybe we need some sort of bifurcation that makes a cheaper form for getting rid of, for asserting patents at the low end and getting rid of invalid claims at the low end while preserving the more thorough, the more, you know, gold plated, but let's really dig into this adjudication for the high value disputes.
Now, Jason, you wanted to jump in and contest my joke about trolls. Well, you can define a troll.
I think I can, in the sense that there are two levels of definition. One is that I think trolls are, it's a useful rhetorical word to sort of say that there are actors in the system we don't want in the system. And then when you get into the specifics, I think it's, you know, the patent assertion entity has become the kind of, you know, term of art. But I think it's folks who, any entity or person who does not participate at all in the research, development, design, or commercialization of the patent they're asserting, there are very few, and I want to get on to Roger's point about this theoretical liquidity kind of market. This is the economic talk. But the empirical studies, and there have been many now that have come out, there are over a dozen, that look at what are the costs and benefits of patent trolling, right? Of having entities that assert patents that don't have any connection to the actual invention or to the development or to any commercialization whatsoever. There are huge costs on defendants where they take money out of R&D budgets, where they don't hire engineers, where they don't commercialize or market their own products in order to defend. The money gets shifted to defense lawyers or to paying licensing fees, and it has substantial implications. There are studies and surveys that show that they hire less people, they produce less products, they do less innovation. On the other side, you say, oh, well, maybe that money is somehow funneling, you know, the plaintiffs and the patent assertion entities are somehow funneling the money back to small inventors or to fund investment. No evidence, zero. In fact, This American Life had a big series on this, looking at intellectual ventures, looking at other...
Well, if Ira Glass said it, it must be true.
Well, look, right, they went and investigated, and they asked these assertion entities, can you point us to a single person or a single company that you've actually helped commercialize something that's actually had any substantial impact on the economy, or what's the success story here? And they couldn't give them anything. All they could give them were a few inventors who were sort of holed up in caves somewhere, hoping for a payout on something they never commercialized, and quite frankly, wasn't even being used today in any connection to the patent that was being asserted.
But so, let's go beyond the anecdote. Yeah. Let's go beyond the anecdote. So I met with Intellectual Ventures. Peter Detkin came to my office to see if we couldn't find some common ground, and his lobbyist said, well, what if we had best practices?
Explain to Intellectual Ventures.
So Intellectual Ventures is the biggest troll. Funded by Nathan Myhrvold and Bill Gates and Peter Detkin out of Intel and a couple of others. They are acquirers of massive, massive numbers of patents.
So they have a huge portfolio of
tens of thousands of patents. And some of them are probably extremely high quality patents. And their business model is really simple. They're going to be an intellectual asset company, and they're going to go out and mine those patents and then go after very large entities for very large amounts of money. Now, they also take a lot of their trashy patents and give them to trashy trolls who go out and sue my guys for $5,000 and $25,000. And it's a game. And oftentimes they keep a back end on that. So, but I put them in a high-class category of high-class problems with gold-plated lawyers because they've got them. But when I sat down with them, and they said, well, you know, patent trolls aren't all bad. Are we in a patent assertion entities, right? This is a new industry, they said. Peter Detkin says, it's a new industry. Congress should look at us. So they said, well, what about best practices? I said, okay, who can we compare patent assertion entities to? Ah, you know what? How about ASCAP and BMI? ASCAP and BMI go to small songwriters who write music. And they say, we will collectively aggregate lots of rights around songs and we'll license them to radio stations and to movie theaters and to bars and restaurants, and then we'll give you back money. And every year, ASCAP and BMI issue a report. They say, we collected $878 million, a record year, and we sent back to songwriters, who, by the way, are on our board, $799 million. Our overhead rate is this. We had to spend this on litigation. I said, how about if you report every year how much money actually goes back to inventors? They said, well, we can't do that. I said, why not? I said, what's the big deal? Well, we can't do that. Okay. What would you consider to be a mark of a good patent troll, best practices? They don't have anything. Now, they do have trading cards, because they heard enough anecdotes and they created some trading cards, literally, of, you know, Joe Inventor, and, you know, in her kitchen inventing something, and, you know, she's sold her patent to Intellectual Ventures. Anecdotes are great, and I can use them with the best of them.
We believe that.
The problem is not the anecdotes. The problem really is the macro challenge here. And if they don't have best practices for their business and they're not willing to be transparent about their business, then that answers a lot of questions.
Richard, you wanted to get
in. I'm never troubled about the transparency stuff. I'm troubled about the validity stuff. And, you know, to the extent that you are engaged in this situation, here's what I would say. Suppose what you do is you have two kinds of licenses, one of which will take something and then will sell it off to somebody else and then give you back part of it. That's a sharing arrangement. But the other kind of license somebody can say is, look, we don't know this thing anymore. There's no point in having an expensive sharing arrangement. We'll make an outright transfer to you. There's nothing illegal about an outright transfer. And at that particular point, you would not expect to see any money going back after the case is won. All you'd have to do is to look elsewhere where the studies may not cover it as to how much money was transferred to these guys to begin with. Mm-hmm. If that number is positive, and I don't think they get the things for zero, then what you can say is the compensation that the original inventors and their pools receive is in a different time frame, and it's an encouragement in exactly the same way. So the issue then is, well, are we so smart as to say that the BMI model ought to be used everywhere else? And the answer is, there's no reason why that should be the accurate model. When you're dealing with copyrights, everybody knows what the songs are. There's no real question when they're played as to whether or not it would be an infringing event without it.
Tell that to George Harrison.
Though. Well, I mean, my sweet Lord, I don't know whether to tell it to him. Nobody got the joke. But, you know, you did, but you're old enough, I guess. But what happens is, you know, you sell these things off, you take the things back. That's a model, in effect, in which validity is not an issue. It's a collection agency. But when you start dealing with patents, which are more complicated, the users are much more heterogeneous at the bottom end of the thing. You need a different kind of specialization and a different kind of model. To give you a comparison, what happens is there are many companies which are debt collectors. And you can say about, oh, these debt collectors, you know, what do? They don't make anything. They never commercialize anything. They never report anything back. Well, the answer is they work on a rather different model, and the model is you transfer the payment to us because we're a better collector, which means that you have more confidence in your rights at the front end, and they don't have transparency in any situation. So I think what you really need to do is to have a much more granulated view about the way in which these markets work, and that gets back to the point which one always raises about litigation. Is it a form of aggression when you start to sue somebody? And the answer is it is surely a form of aggression when you bring a claim or when you resist a claim. And so the ultimate issue is what's the two rates of error associated with these operations? And the reason that procedure is very important is if you've got good procedures that weed these things out, then things are going to change. And I could talk about ways in which I think this could be done, but I think I've spoken enough.
So I want to pick up on something you just said, Richard, which is the comparison to debt collectors. Because in some ways, what do debt collectors do? Let's say I am a department store or a mom-and-pop entity, I have claims that have been defaulted on. Somebody owes me money. My customers owe me money. I could, if I wanted to, go out and try to collect on all of these claims. But, you know, I know how to run a business. I'm not so good at sort of running litigation. So what do? I sell my claims or enter into some arrangement with a debt collector. The debt collector has expertise in collecting claims, and we generally think that this is a good thing because it means that the claim is now in the hands of someone who can maximize the value of the claim, and some of that value will be passed back to the original owner. However, we have something called the Fair Debt Collection Practices Act. We have lots of regulation and statutory and administrative regulation of debt collectors. So what is it about the transfer of some claims that we think raises issues, but not other claims? I mean, we don't see it in every single market. What is it? Why is it that in some markets we worry about abuse, but in others we don't?
Yeah, I will. And I think it's interesting because your question now is really cutting back against your earlier who cares about process question.
Yeah, yeah. I'm schizoid, so, you know, I go back and forth on these things.
You're capable of learning.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. I learned. That's right.
On the other hand. So the answer to that, clearly, is there isn't a fundamental difference. You can look at problems, as we say, at the harassment of consumers that you just decide you're maybe in the absolute sense of creating the maximum property rights, you should allow endless harassment of consumers, but that's maybe not the ultimate good. Right. So we tinker at the margin. The practice of an entity like Innovatio that's been in litigation recently at doing exactly what you describe and kind of going after people saying, you need to send us $250, an amount that's not worth contesting, and for using a product sold by Cisco, which has ample resources to take on the validity issue, could you imagine making some statutory changes that would allow Cisco to step in and defend?
Right.
You could imagine that.
Right.
I'm a busy litigator. I'm not a policy wonk. I don't know what all the proposals on the table are. I'm not an expert in that. But that's a rational discussion.
Yeah, because we have real party and interest rules, basically.
Yeah. Me, that is saying, well, that's a discussion that addresses an identifiable concern. What I worry about is when you have a discussion that says, look, there's something out there called trolls, and not to be, just to fire off a missile to make it an interesting discussion, that was referred to as a useful rhetorical word. Well, I'm concerned about rhetorical words in a policy debate. I love them in the courtroom, but in a policy debate, if we're trying to get somewhere, I want to stay away from that. As I say, I know them when I see them when they sue my client, but there isn't a bright line definition. So I think exactly what you said, which is let's find a match between an identified problem and a rational solution to that problem, rather than just saying, you know what, the patent system is, quote, broken, which I feel strongly that it isn't at a conceptual level. So let's drill some more holes in it.
Well, I should say, like, the 10 different bills that have been introduced in Congress, they have very specific provisions, which I think we can talk about, and I think you're right. In the end, when we get to legislation or to court decisions, we're going to get very specific fixes for very specific problems. To the debt collection example, actually, it's a really good counterexample, I think, because you can see what if the debt collectors went after people who had no idea that they were being targeted for debt collection, not just because they didn't pay, because they never went into the store in the first place? In other words, there's a choice of going in the store, making a transaction. You at least probably have some awareness, one would hope, that you walked in the store and bought something and didn't pay for it, or you bought it online or whatever. In a lot of these cases of patent infringement, there was no awareness that a patent even existed. Often it was just sitting on a shelf somewhere, kind of gathering dust in someone's portfolio and not being commercialized at all. And that's where the trolls go and they acquire it. And then it gets asserted against you, and you didn't have anything to do with it at all in the first place. And then it costs you $2.6 million to litigate whether or not you owe a debt in that sense. So I think the debt collection is actually interesting because you have a sense of notice, right, when you enter into transactions that there might be some sort of risk that they'll come after you if you don't pay. And then also the cost of opposing a debt collection for some people might still be too high if they're very poor. But I mean, there's going to be varying levels, whereas here, it's hard to have cheap patent litigation at all.
So can I comment on that? Look, I mean, I think you have a naive view as to how simple debt collection action is. I can tell you.
I'm not saying it's simple.
I can tell you the stories where, for example, my wife has been sued because she has the same name as somebody else. She never entered into any of these particular transactions. We had exactly the same.
Is that what she told you?
I actually compared the signatures between what was on.
So you investigated. Okay,
I did investigate. It was perfectly clear. It took us forever to kind of clear our names through administrative stuff. There were all sorts of suits against collection agencies for pursuing the wrong person, ruining credit records, and all the rest of the thing. I mean, all that I want to say about it is I make the comparison because the complexities go all the way down. And, you know, what Roger said was perfectly sensible, and here's one possibility. Normally, when you sell a product as a big guy to a small guy, you give them implied warranties of fitness and other things. And Roger's proposal says, look, Google will, or Qualcomm, when it has a small guy, they will agree to substitute themselves in as a defendant to take over the case. And they'll do that across the board. At that point, it becomes credible. And now you've got big guy against big guy. And you don't have to change anything about the rules of the assignment on the plaintiff's side. What you have to do is essentially to allow the flexibility on the defendant's side.
And that's one of the options in the litigation, in the legislation, is all these joinder rules, and should we have some sort of a period in which you try to drag in the manufacturer of a product and things like that, or the licensor. But to go to the, to stick with the Fair Debt Collection Practices Act, one of the regulations on the Fair Debt Collection Practices Act is something that is being considered for the patent bill. And there's the patent bill, by the way, is being marked up by the House Judiciary Committee today. And there will be amendments about demand letter transparency. And the idea is, when you send a demand letter, you have to tell people, what's the patent number? What's the specific claim they're infringing? And what's the specific function that is doing the infringing? What is the infringing activity? Yeah. And that level of specificity serves two purposes. One is it creates, it limits the amount of research and cost to the recipient, because you've told them precisely what they're doing and precisely how it infringes and which claim, and they can do a much quicker analysis of whether this is a legitimate patent and they're legitimately infringing and they need to pay a license, as opposed to just blindly. And literally these, you know, anecdotes, I got a lot of them. People call up and they say, I got this letter, tell me about how I'm infringing. Yeah, no comment.
Yeah, but
hire a lawyer, see you in court. No, but wait. So that amount of specificity is helpful in the demand letter case. The Fair Debt Collection Practices Act also, the other thing that it does is it requires, it is a heightened burden for the asserter. You can't just send out 13,000 demand letters like MPHJ has done to everybody that owns a fax scanner in, you know, 13 states, literally. And this is the Cisco case, you know, where they've already licensed it. You can't just blindly send out letters to my client with a link to their homepage. Force them to actually do their homework, and then they will make more prudent assertions and smarter assertions and probably more credible assertions. So that is a process that is associated with both the quality and the infringement that just says, put everybody on real notice as to what's going on.
Let me give an answer, a very simple answer. That is arguably a very sensible rule, much like the reforms in the security laws where you require that you plead the materiality and so forth with precision. But it's a rule that doesn't address a troll problem. It is a rule that addresses a plaintiff's problem. And it's exactly the same issue if you have a patent assertion entity or if you have the original guy as the inventor who decides not to specialize.
No, but we want it in demand letters.
Look, a demand letter could be issued by anybody, including the patent holder. So you're not talking about a reform of trolls. You're trying to talk about how you control litigation type issues. And, I'm not against that.
Jason, Roger.
I think what it's saying, though, is that while it will be applicable to all plaintiffs, the trolls are the ones that will reform. The other plaintiffs, you end up specifying anyway. If you're going to follow through in litigation, you know, many jurisdictions already have rules that force you to do infringement and invalidity charts early on and things. And the repeat players already do that. They often send the charts in the demand letter too, but the trolls are the ones who are exploiting the notice in the pleading
it's
requirement.
It's not an argument. It simply says the differential impact of the rule. Good. Okay.
The word troll is just semantics.
We can ignore the word troll.
Exactly. Roger has the floor.
I really think that it confuses more than it clarifies to use the word troll, and I want to respond though substantively to that. And again, my client invests billions and sells billions in products exploiting their patents. In terms of kind of the classic trolls, we only see them as we are defendants against them. So I am not here representing intellectual ventures. But Professor Schultz's basic, the way he wants to define that is an entity that has nothing to do with exploiting the technology, with developing the technology. And I just want to take issue with that because that's kind of a fundamental disconnect from the concept of our patent law and the basic deal of the patent law, which says we want to make, motivate people to make inventions and to disclose them to the world, to teach them to the world in a published patent. There's nothing about the patent law deal since the earliest days of the Republic that says the goal of the patent law is to drive inventors to bring their product to market. The goal of the patent law is to drive people to invent and bring that art to the market through publication of a patent, and it's nice if they want to exploit it as well. They are free to either exploit it by making a product and protecting that with the patent or by licensing the patent. So the question of whether an entity does or does not make the product that uses the patent, to my mind, if you want to have a discussion that that's a bad thing for the world, then you're backing up and having a very fundamental discussion about our patent system. And the thing I would just like to say about our patent system, Professor Schultz said something early on, and I'm not sure whether I got the context, but he seemed to be saying that patents as a whole were impeding innovation at present.
No, just the patent assertion entities.
Okay.
That's right.
I just want to emphasize that if we're talking about a system that on the whole is critical and works really well. I see glimpses of that as I see, you know, kind of corporate decision makers making investment decisions. If you're going to put $1 billion here, you need to know that if you develop something truly novel that you're going to be able to get some value out of that. And at the small scale, in Silicon Valley, when venture capitalists are being asked to invest a few million here and a few million there, which is, drives California in ways that other countries just envy, one of their first questions is, before making an investment, is, am I going to be able to get IP protection on this? So this stuff is really functionally important. And so as we identify issues, and there are always issues, it is a far from perfect system. And if you wanted to ask me questions about quality of patents from patents that I've litigated about, you know, I could go on and on. So there's always room for improvement. We just have to make sure that we focus on matching cures to problems rather than just kind of damning the system and taking a whack at it.
So I think one response to that, and then I think maybe we can open it up for questions.
Well, let me just quickly say, like, I don't think anyone's damning the system as a bad system. I think this is about this particular set of problems. I did want to make two quick points about the debt collection thing. I'm thinking about it. I don't know the percentage of, you know, misidentified people who are called up, but the studies now that are coming out say that patent assertion entities are responsible for anywhere between 40 and 70% of newly filed patent lawsuits in the United States. In one study in 2012, it was 62% of all new patent lawsuits. So if these are situations of the same caliber where someone is misidentified or whether the problems are huge with the claim, it's a pretty big percentage. The other thing is, you knew pretty much right away, probably when you saw the signature, that it wasn't your wife's signature. And that doesn't cost you hundreds of thousands of dollars of lawyer time to figure out whether you infringe your claim or not.
Well, let's put it this
I hope
way.
Not.
That was one anecdote, but if you go and you look at the reports on this issue, sometimes it takes thousands of hours of effort to clear your name when the transactions are more complicated.
But you at least know it's wrong right away.
Oh, no, you don't really know that it's wrong right away. I mean, I think, Jason, I've worked in that system. The basic law of conquest in all cases is the closer you get to any particular system, the greater the warts in its operation. And that's true of every property system, every entitlement system that I've ever seen. And all we're saying on the opposite side is that if there are reforms that you need, you make those reforms, whether they apply to assignors or to assignees. If it turns out that the trolls, so-called, are the bigger offenders, it will have a greater impact upon them. But there is no reason to have what you might want to call a troll-specific reform, which you cannot generalize to all plaintiffs in all patent cases.
But we haven't spent any time talking about patent quality.
Well, I'm going to talk about that too.
Patent quality, bad, low-quality patents, patents that should not have been issued, particularly software and business method patents between 1994, when they were first allowed, until 2004, 2005, when John Dudas came in as PTO, head of PTO, and finally
That's
cleaned the up the system a little bit. They were issuing software patents and business method patents for a decade with very little expertise in-house, which the Patent and Trademark Office admits. And very little expertise, no prior art to look at, because they didn't even know where to look. Google didn't exist for many of those years. The standard for getting a patent is so low, and the standard for invalidating a patent in court is so high. The question is in many respects, not we have fixed the patent approval system to some degree on a going forward basis, and that was the AIA, the American Invents Act in 2011. What are we going to do about the thousands and thousands of trashy patents that were created back then and literally are things like a method, not the method. Remember, a business method patent is a method of transferring data from a mobile device to a network back to a mobile device based on user expectations. Really, like, if you bought this, you'd like that.
Yeah, but John.
No. These are hugely broad, vague patents that are being used like bludgeons against a lot of folks. And the question is, I think
that has nothing to do with the troll question.
No. It does because they're being used by the trolls. And I would say to you, it has a lot to do with they are empowering. And so what do we do because if you disarm, that's the way you disarm bad actors. Let's assume there's some bad actors or at least some bad practices going on, right? We won't use words like trolls or PEs. There are people using vague, overbroad, should never have been issued patents in an abusive fashion.
There's no disagreement about that.
So how do we fix it?
But let me just sort of say, what you're talking about is no novel issue. The last of the claims in the Morse patent was a device to use electromagnetic waves to transmit information, and it was struck down. So clearly there are mistakes in the system. But those mistakes are every bit as deadly if they're brought by the original patent inventor or if they're brought by a third party. So the question what happens is, here's a proposal. You bring a trashy patent. You let the major defender defend it. Then what you do is you use defensive collateral estoppel so they can't assert it in third cases. That's a way of handling the problem.
That's a gold-plated way.
Well, no, it's not, actually.
I'm very happy to have caused lots of disagreement. That was my job. And well done. This is a no-weapon zone, so we're okay. I patented that, by the way.
Trademarked it.
Trademarked it. No, but the method for securing the room.
Creating it has been patented.
The method or a method?
Just a method. Just a method. Questions.
So I have two questions.
Could you just identify?
Yeah. I'm Dolly. I'm a student here.
What year?
I'm a 2L. Okay. My first question is, Roger mentioned we need a cheaper forum for these smaller NPEs, or to like defend against these smaller NPEs, and I guess I'm wondering, don't the post-grant challenges like IPR at the PTAB solve a lot of those problems because they do provide a cheaper alternative that address a lot, I mean the structural build of that system, you know, simplifies like the 78 claims example where you would only address the major claims.
Yeah, first of all, if you had an alternative kind of lower value dispute resolution process for patents, I certainly wouldn't draw the line based on whether it's an NPE or not, because you could have, right. It's a value question. Mm-hmm. It's a transaction cost question. Assuming that, I think that the new post-issuance examination processes may go some way down that road. For instance, in allowing the big boy behind the retail players to step in and attack a patent. There are enough patents that most of which never amount to anything. You have to understand the proportion of patents that are ever asserted and ever generate a penny of revenue is quite small. Many things are invented. Not that many things actually turn out to be worth that much. It's a cruel world. So you don't know which ones to focus on until there's some controversy. So just kind of For a major company to just kind of as a matter of policy go in and fight re-examinations of every patent they don't like that comes out of the patent office, that's not practical. Mm-hmm. So you need a process that kind of kicks in once somebody cares about that patent. Yeah,
the key, you're right with one caveat, which is right now, in most of these instances, the patent owner can assert in court and if you file a re-exam or take through one of these post-grant proceedings, there's some question of what happens with the litigation.
Yes, that's the issue.
And so if you have an automatic stay or you have a presumption of stay of the litigation pending the result in the patent office, I think you get a huge advantage there, depending on the quality of the patent examiner and what the patent office can actually look at. Because there are some forms of prior art and some forms of invalidity that the patent office won't look at in those re-exam processes. But assuming it can do a thorough review and you can stay the litigation, I think it's a very effective tool.
Now, look, I have some, there's some serious complications here. One of the things is that it's one thing to try to challenge a patent in post-grant review when there's been no adjudication on it, but many of the cases involve patents that have been adjudicated as favorable, and then somebody tries to challenge them with an administrative process. That I regard as essentially disastrous. And
why?
Why? Because what happens is when you talk about the level of confidence that you have in adjudication, it is nothing like the level of confidence that you have in an initial grant. These guys have gone through months and weeks of this stuff, and the data treasury cases on which I work for the patent holder, I mean, we won 6 or 7 of these cases consistently against every conceivable type of challenge, and the thought that after that kind of verification you could go back into a PTO is very dangerous, and let me explain why. One is that under the AIA, the selection of the judge to actually hear the reexamination is left in the discretion of somebody who's in charge of the office.
That's the America Invents Act.
And this is extremely dangerous. I mean, in court, you do this by rotation. In this case, what you could do is you could pick an expert by field, but also by side. And I don't think any person should have that much of an ability on it. So I think there's a danger of bias with respect to it. Also, I do think that there's a serious separation of powers issue when you have a final adjudication in a court to go back into an administrative agency. It turned what?
It's a plot
problem, which I think is very serious. Thank you.
We already have, as Roger has said in a way, and I sat with Bob Stoll, who was also the head of the Patent and Trademark Office for several years on a panel, and the Patent and Trademark Office readily admits the best examiners do re-exams. Because in the initial application process, nobody knows whether this patent is going to be worth a damn or this invention is worth a damn. And they go through, and the patent examiner gives it about 20 hours of time. God bless him. But the private practice lawyer, the prosecutor, is giving it 200 hours of time. And the goal of the private practice lawyer, the prosecutor, is to make it the biggest, broadest set of claims to cover as much as possible, because that's what you're paying them to do.
But to Richard's point, the litigator gives it 2,000 hours.
But,
so after you've been through the litigation process, you really have beat that patent and beat the prior art in a way that nobody could possibly replicate or afford to replicate in any other context. And there is the concern, let's suppose that many patents that are asserted, there's merit, there was investment, there was invention, you actually did mean to create an asset of value, you do want that to happen. The question of staying pending reexamination is a challenging one. There are some jurisdictions that at least historically have commonly stayed litigation pending reexaminations, and there are others that will not even consider it. And so the practice around the country is quite different, and both of them have problems. There are times when you would think, you know, it would be nice to hear from the Patent Office on this, but in fact, the reexamination process coupled with the stay often serves simply as a multi-year delaying tactic for people who ought to have been paying royalties. I can tell you right now, the Patent Office, and I know the new statute edicts that they do this thing quickly, you know, good luck with that.
Can't happen.
But the judges
saying, you know, we have a problem, so let's create more routes of delay is also a problem.
Judges give extraordinary deference to the Patent Office on the granting of a patent. It's not Chevron deference, but it's pretty darn close. So they, you know, the hurdle to invalidate a patent in court is a much higher hurdle than is the lower hurdle to get the patent. So in fact, the Patent Office might say, you know what, you know, as Gilda Radner used to say, never mind, we didn't mean to issue that patent. And yet the court would say, you haven't hit the burden of proof, which is much higher, to invalidate a patent that's previously been issued. And so in fact, going back to the Patent Office to let them have a do-over, because they screwed up, whether it's the Arrival Star patent that after they got millions and millions of dollars in royalties from public transit agencies, they then turn around and realize that, oh, never mind, we never should have issued that patent. Right? There's a whole lot of garbage out there that is being exploited.
So let me intervene here for two reasons. One, I want to take more questions from the floor. And second, given the age of the audience, I want to explain who Gilda Radner was. And Miss Emily Latella was a character who would sort of mishear something. You know, she would be asked to comment on, you know, violence on television. She would then say there are too many violins on television, and then she would say, oh, never mind. So, yes, with that very, very important substantive point, other questions from
Saturday
the floor? Other questions?
Questions
on YouTube. I'm David. I'm a third-year student here at the law school. I think my issue with the way the modern patent system and modern practices are working really has to do with something that Mr. Brooks brought up, and it's that the fact that the modern system, the modern practices really don't comport with the policy reasons that kind of underlie the putting in the patent and the copyright clause in the Constitution, which is to drive invention that would serve, you know, sort of the public good, putting things that are out there that are useful or creative or what have you. And I think that a system that would better reflect that constitutional goal, the actual purpose of the clause, would be something that would, you know, kind of as you suggested, require you to engage in some sort of, after you've invented, basically retuning the quid pro quo. That after you've invented, you have to either practice or engage in some sort of bona fide attempt to license that patent and get it out there into practice instead of just sitting on the rights.
So a labor theory of property.
That, but can I comment?
My question is, I mean, I think that the, you know, it, maybe there's congressional drive to do something like that, but what about some sort of court system, or excuse me, court solution, you know, rooted
in... Let me actually, this is a fantastic question, so let me slightly tweak it a little bit, because what you're pointing at is something I find really fascinating about patent law. In my view, much of the rhetoric around patent is focused on the small inventor in a basement, sort of tinkering away, who then invents the, you know, the telephone or the light bulb. That's our vision, even though for the bulk of major patent development, it really is large corporate entities. Although, as John can talk about now with apps and so forth, you really do have small inventors who are creating things. So I just want to add that and then open it up for
First of all, I think you're wrong on the basic question of whether or not you could deep six a patent. It goes back a long time, a case called Continental Bag, 1908, which said you can do it. And it's extremely important. Take the following case. You're in the drug invention business, and you invent the drug, and you call it Celebrex. And then you also have another molecule out there, which is like Vioxx, or at least arguably covers it. There is nothing which says that you have to try to develop two drugs in the same market in competition with each other. It may well be that the perfectly rational and permissible strategy is to use one pocket patent to block and the other one to start to develop. And under your view about this is if you come up with two inventions, you necessarily have to sacrifice one. Now, if it turns out that there's a complementary market for both of them, there are dual development strategies and licensing strategies that could be used to exploit this. But I think if you actually know the way in which these particular industries work, whenever there are substitute inventions, it does not necessarily follow that you have to abandon one of them, having developed both of them.
Also, inventions are still good even if you don't practice them, which is the term for, you know, you don't create things from them, but you have to disclose them. And you have to disclose them clearly, and the Patent Office has failed miserably at making sure that people can understand, people even in that science, who are professionals in that field, can understand what you have invented and what it covers. And so in a property right, you should know the meets and bounds of the property. Mm-hmm. And there are great problems, which is why we have such huge litigation, particularly around these method patents. If it's a technological patent, right, I figured out a way to make the bottom of the glass thicker and water doesn't go through it and whatever, right? This is technological. It's easy to understand at least what it is. With method patents in particular, with business method patents in particular, you can't understand what the heck they've covered, and that's one of the reasons they get litigated such a high percentage of the time.
But I think the reason there are 10 bills in Congress right now about this is because people have substantial questions about what is the benefit that we're getting for the cost of having patents. And you come up with an idea of a policy balance for that, and I think that's right. And what I think we're saying is, yeah, like the system overall doesn't need to be changed across the board, but what it does need is to identify where the policy is not working. And I think in this instance, when you have assertion entities that I think have no connection at all to any of the sort of invention or disclosure, then I think you can look at reforms that will curtail the exploitive nature of their tactics.
Well, let me just comment on a couple of things. Again, we're back to an assertion entity that had nothing to do with the development or the disclosure. If you had made a significant invention, and you filed a patent application in which you well described and disclosed what your invention was, it was important, it was potentially valuable, and you had no capital. I don't know if this rings like realistic for any of you. what we're basically saying when we criticize organization or devalue patents in the hands of organizations that didn't develop and didn't do the disclosure is to reduce your right to sell your asset. That's what we're saying. Now, on your specific question about, well, shouldn't we require some bona fide effort either to develop or to license? Let me just tell you as a litigator, here's a question I got from a client, or yeah, I was a client at one time. You know, we would really like to have a licensing program and get so-and-so paying us a bunch of money. How can we do that without suing? And the answer is, you know what? People don't just pay you a bunch of money unless there's a credible threat. That's just what property rights are about. If you could stay in the apartment you're in this city for free and nobody could do anything about it, you might not pay so much. So property rights require somebody like me to enforce them. So the honest, sad truth, given the way of the world and the fact that people don't like to hand over money for nothing, is that making a demand and potentially filing a lawsuit is how you go about a good faith licensing effort. I'm just sorry to say that.
Can I make one little comment? One little. Look, another reason why the meets and bounds is so important and why it is that inventors actually strive to do them is their first encounter with the world of commerce is not in litigation, it's within financing and sale. And if they don't have something with meets and bounds that's coherent, they cannot mortgage it and they cannot sell it. So there's a lot of self-correction in this system.
There was a question right here.
Mario Loyola, fellow at the Classical Liberal Institute. I'm very ignorant of this area of the law.
Hasn't stopped me.
Professor Epstein knows. Yeah. I never say that, so when I do, I really mean it. So I really don't know anything about this area of the law. And so I may ask a very ignorant question. But it got me thinking when you all were talking about the debt collector analogy, that's a sort of very weird analogy to draw because the debtor is in such a different position. I mean, the consumer debtor is in such a different position than the defendant in a patent case. And isn't sort of the primary analogy to draw to a property registry? And isn't the question, I think you were talking about this earlier, process patents as opposed the distinction between business methods as opposed to the science. Isn't the threshold question whether the defendant was properly on notice or could have been on notice of a possible patent infringement? And if the patent in question, the registration in question couldn't have put anybody on notice or couldn't have put that defendant on notice, then from a policy point of view, isn't that the threshold first thing that you want to deal
with? That's the disclosure requirement.
The core of the patent law says that if the patent, and all patents are public, I mean, that's why it's called a patent. If it doesn't give notice, if it doesn't describe the invention to one of skill in the art, maybe not to you and me, given many arts, then it's not valid. So the patent law is structured, it's doctrinally at least, insists on exactly what you said. Now, you know, how thoroughly does it deliver is another question, but doctrinally, if the patent doesn't give notice, it's not valid.
But when you have hundreds of thousands of patents coming out every year, it's hard to track them all, read them all, costs a lot of money. Yeah. So there are some practical realities around information costs.
But that's actually my question is, what is the, so if I'm going into a new line of business, what can I do to do the appropriate, so because I know if I'm like in Oklahoma and it's 2 years after the Homestead Act and I want to build a house and I know that there might be some.
But this is the difference, this is the problem with real property analogies. Sure. I mean, just the analogy to property in other contexts I think is problematic because you could make an app, right, for say I'm talking your talk here in a sense, but you know, for the iTunes store or whatever, right? You could, in theory, be infringing 10,000 patents by making that one app. And there's no, it's not like a house where only so many people could own that plot of land, and it's only one house, and it's on one plot of land. I mean, there's a way in which the information markets just don't operate in that same kind of constraint around what your risks are and how you can assess them.
But look, there's a difficulty. This reminds me of the objection that the king had to Idino Meo, the opera by Mozart. He said, the problem with this music is it has too many notes. And Mozart said, it has just the right number of notes. And the point is this. If you've got 10,000 inventions, all of which are valid and covering a particular area, then it would be crazy to say what we need is fewer notes in this thing and have only 5,000 of them kept. What you need to deal with that particular problem is a third-party assembler who puts together patent portfolios that are coherent. One way in which you do that is like Qualcomm. They got lots of inventors, and I can tell you without ever having asked Roger that there's an assignment policy post-invention of inventors. interventions made by the firm that go to the firm so that they get a more coherent policy. So once you do that, the pre-planning means that the guy who is in fact on the opposite end of this thing isn't facing 10,000 separate claims. He's facing one or two claims with respect to 10 patents. And the only thing he has to worry about is not where the breaks are within the system. It has to do with the edges as against the rest of the world.
Question over here.
Hi, my name is Amine, and I'm also 1L, so very ignorant on this as well. But basically, my whole experience was that This American Life that you referenced, which is a very interesting talk. But I was wondering if you could talk a little bit more. Mr. Potter said something about how the heightened pleading or heightened demand requirements could help by giving notice. And then Professor Epstein responded that no, all you need is this sort of one defendant who can take care of the big defendant who can take care of the claim, and then you're sort of barred. Can you just explain how that would solve Mr. Potter's problem?
So both, in a sense, one is a notice issue, and the other is a real party and interest issue.
So I think what Richard was saying is, if you're one of the 10,000 coffee shops that got a letter saying your in-house Wi-Fi is infringing my patent. And it was legitimate, right? This guy was a former engineer at Broadcom. Broadcom had licensed the Wi-Fi patent to Cisco and every other router company in the country. And the patent was at the end of its life, essentially. It was like at 19 years and old. And this engineer said to, and they were retiring the patent, essentially. And the engineer said to Broadcom, I'll buy that patent from you. And he did. And then he said, you know what, these guys, because remember, IP law, you can take a bite at every level of the food chain, right? So unless you lose on the patent exhaustion issue, which clearly they were.
It's a big issue. But the transaction costs may make it impossible to dispute.
And Cisco tried to intervene in that case, and the judge wouldn't hear it. And Cisco brought a RICO action against MPHJ in that case, and the judge threw it out. I testified next to the Cisco general counsel 2 weeks ago in the Senate Commerce Committee about demand letter reform, at the whole idea that this company, this guy, bought the patent for a song, and he then said...
Quite literally, right?
Yeah, seriously. And then he said,
and he had to pay BMI.
These 20,000 guys with Wi-Fi who have no idea that they might have gotten the patent...
They might have
been indemnified or gotten a license when they bought the product from Cisco, but they don't know if they did. I promise they don't know. And he started rolling through state after state, and he's got 5 AGs after him now, which is great.
Well, that's even better.
Actually, so quick question, though. But if he loses against the first person he sues,
defensive collateral estoppel.
Doesn't
but he
defensive
picks
non-mutuals.
His targets,
but he's got
he his targets.
Lose in court.
No, but
and
that's
none of these
smart
guys can afford.
No, all you need to do is essentially, this is, again, one of the things that you and your trade association should do, is if the government won't set up a registry of cases of victimization, you set it up. Yeah. And then what you do is you then have your patent referral system, and you get it out to them so that by amalgamation, you're doing the thing. It's exactly the same thing as on the other side. You start with 10,000 patents. You contract, you compress them into one big thing. You do it on the defendant side. Look, my view about this is, as I said, litigation is aggression. And when you teach this in first-year contracts, there's always a question of whether or not you could set aside settlements on the grounds that they were either without consideration or by economic duress. That problem doesn't go away because we're in the 21st century dealing with patents. But this is the structural kind of change. But note, I don't care whether the abuse is done by the original holder or by the assignee. So it's not, to me, a troll question. It's an abusive process question. They've got one over there. Or over here.
Oh, yes, over here, yes.
And then you can go back to it. Second dibs.
Hi, Dean Alderucci. Dean is my name, not my title. not yet. Anyway.
Thank you for clarifying.
This panel discussion, which started with trolls and has kind of migrated to other issues like the disclosure requirement, et cetera, and given that the disclosure requirement is a primary purpose of the patent system, why isn't all of this anger and energy channeled into modifying the disclosure requirement rather than all these litigation reforms, which may do very good things, but it sounds like, you know, the fact that the public cannot determine without anyone getting sued, the public can't determine whether I infringe patent X. Well, if it costs $2 million of litigation to make that determination, that just sounds ridiculous to me. Why aren't we focusing on that then?
So is it fix the PTO or fix the
publicly
accessible?
It's not just the PTO, it's the rules.
I think it is, actually, because when you're dealing with the high value litigation, I mean, the disclosure requirements of the law are actually quite rigorous. And it's a very well-developed law and refined law, and the Federal Circuit gives it a lot of attention. So it's not that the disclosure requirements need radical change. They're quite rigorous. It's that you have quality issues and cost of adjudication issues.
I should say there is one reform effort there's a part of the AIA that was called the cover business methods process where you could look at some of these business method patents, and in that process, unlike other re-exams and other sort of reviews at the patent office, they would look at 112 issues. The idea is that
better tell them what it is.
Well, 112 is where you have to say, you have to disclose and detail what your invention is, right? Written description requirement. And but one thing to think about there is you can't forget that a lot of the ambiguity comes from the example John was talking about, where they say, and the infringing device, product, or service is, and give the URL of your website. So half of the ambiguity is on what does the patent cover, and the other half of the ambiguity is, do you even infringe it? And one of the things, for anyone who actually does sort of know a lot about patent litigation, know that the cost of what they call construing the claims of the patent is in itself millions of dollars. Like, they read the claim language and they try and figure out what the hell it means, which I always thought was funny. Like, why have a patent issue out of the patent office and then later have to figure out what it means? Like, the fact that we have a claim construction process in and of itself is an admission that all patents are ambiguous.
Now, that's like saying that because you have to construe contracts, the contracts are all ambiguous. Any human enterprise that involves work requires
definition. It's so much bigger in patent litigation, and it's so much more
The alternative is to eliminate, I can eliminate all ambiguity by having no patents.
You don't have to go that far. You're so radical, Richard.
Look, again, a lot of the amalgamation stuff gets rid of conflicts at the boundaries between two patents. And for many of the most important patents, for example, like those with respect to pharmaceutical entities, the boundary line conditions on the primary patents are virtually negligible. And if you're talking about a molecule like Lipitor, you're talking about an income stream over an 11-year period of something in excess of $100 billion. So, one of the problems I think that's very important in this is, you have to not only worry about the level of accuracy in particular cases, you have to do two things. One, you have to figure out how much of the litigation is at the small mom and pop level, and how much is at the big level, and how much it matters. And secondly, this book of business continues to expand. And if, in fact, the number of patents increases, say, tenfold, and the amount of litigation increases twofold or threefold, you can make a very credible argument that practice is made not perfect but better, and it's the rate of litigation with respect to practices that matters more than the total amount.
So even if there's an increase of litigation, it may not be an issue if you have more.
And the patent explosion is there. There was an argument made many years ago that the patent thicket would stifle innovation. And it turns out every generation it gets thicker, so-called, and yet the rate of patent growth continues to get larger. And the clear prediction of those articles from the early part of the century, of this century at least, was that sooner or later it would start to turn down, and that just has not happened.
But we also have a race to file patents now. The first to file system, and I wasn't involved in that debate in the AIA,
a quick explanation. At one time in American law, the rule was the first to invent receive protection, and
gets
then
the patent.
Gets the patent.
Right.
Gets
the patent. Some of these people were born.
And then that has been changed now, so it's the first to file.
So what happens is you have a race to file the patent, and claim, put your stake in the ground, and large companies, and this all started with IBM in the 80s when Lou Gerstner came in and said, this company's bankrupt, how am I going to fix this? And he said, we got all this technology sitting on the shelf and we got patents, let's go out and start licensing people who are infringing our patents. I mean, that's where the patent assertion business in a mass way started. And it became an arms race. And now all of these companies, Microsoft, Google buys companies for their patents and then finds out they're not as valuable as they thought. But Microsoft and AT&T and Apple, they're hiring patent lawyers to go around and interview engineers. And I know this because I have a 90-person company who hired his first in-house lawyer. I wasn't a contracts lawyer to get more business. I was a patent lawyer. He said, go interview our 35 engineers and start filing patents based on what they tell you they're doing.
But that's a good thing.
It's a terrible thing because they're filing crappy patents.
Not if they're good patents. They're
not. Well, whether it's good or not, it's not. Whether it's good or not, it's not.
Wait a second. Let John just finish his point and then
we have this extraordinary abundance of patents. People are patenting, you know, an improvement in the nail clipper and then the next improvement in the nail clipper and the next improvement. And nobody gives a damn about the nail clipper.
Then you'll sell the old thing. Voice of reason.
Having patent lawyers go around and interview engineers and research companies to make disclosures and file patents is what's been going on for decades. And somebody mentioned, kind of in the context of mom and pop, the telephone and the phonograph. And in fact, those came from major well-funded research shops mm-hmm. that were doing exactly this and were totally patent-driven. If you read on Edison, I mean, he would not have done what he did without patents.
And he was a frequent litigator.
As was Alexander Graham Bell, benefactor of humanity. But when you say that you're sending lawyers to interview engineers and file patents, what you just said is that you're causing a company to investigate what it's researching and publish it to the world, which is what the patent system is supposed to do.
There's one other point here that is really important, which is sic tempus gloria mundi. Originally, one of the great reforms of the patent system was that, oh, we now get first to file instead of first to invent. That was the big calling card of the reform of the AIA. Now, all of a sudden, it's got to go back to the other argument. Now, it turns out both systems have incredible weaknesses, because if you're doing first to invent, you have to show continuous application in the direction. But if you're doing first to file, this is not like real estate filing. You have to prove that you have not derived your filed invention from somebody else's work. And the truth is, there is an urge to file fast under both systems because nobody wants to be litigating uphill, which is what always happens if you come in second.
My point is that I think companies, because it's an arms race, patents have become an arms race, and the litigation wars have gotten so big, is that companies are filing. It used to be a patent was a mark of achievement. Now it's just a mark of an idea that might become an achievement, maybe one day down the road, and you can file 100 patents on it if you tweak it different ways, and they're being much more aggressive about filing. And that leads to patents that are not always being exploited, but somebody, whether it's in-house or outside, and either way is fine, if it's a PAE or not, but those patents are suddenly becoming litigation weapons in ways that were not anticipated by the system. I would argue are harmful.
That is not the dominant strategy. The dominant strategy is to have solid, strong patents rather than lots of crappy little ones. You got more questions?
We have, let's take one more question very quickly, and then.
My name is Daryl Steiger, and I'm a first year, so I'm not as knowledgeable. But I did have a question. John, you brought up a proposal for BMI, how they disclose and are very transparent. Mm-hmm. I wanted to know how you think that would fix the patent system, and why Professor Epstein doesn't think transparency is necessary in all situations.
I don't think that would fix the patent system. I think what happened was Intellectual Ventures came to me and said, we want to have a, because we're having this debate about, you know, are PAEs good or bad, we want to define what's a good PAE, right? Whether a good troll, a good PAE, right? And what they like to claim, the PAEs, is we're in the invention liquidity market, the technology, the patent liquidity market. This is good for commerce, and it's good for small inventors. I said, well, if you're good for small inventors, then show us the small inventors and how much money you're pushing back to the original inventors, whether it's a university, whether it's just a little guy in a garage, or whoever it is. They didn't want to do that because, for whatever reasons, they're not. And I didn't, you know, it wasn't about, I didn't even ask them, you know, specify which inventor got how much money. It was, this year we made $1 billion and 100 million or 800 million or 500 or whatever went back to, you know, the original inventors. The whole idea is, are you incentivizing creativity and innovation? And show us that you are,
Richard.
You don't want to disclose that information because it gives you information about your rate of return on investment, which may induce people to come into a business you'd rather keep them out of. And so there's a trade secret element in all of these disclosures on financial matters. Isn't that true with your clients, Roger?
Yes.
But that was a best practices. They were asking me,
I think it's a bad practice.
John's talking about the aggregate, not the individual.
Well, it doesn't matter. I mean, look, if you've ever worked with any of these companies, The level of paranoia about trade secrets is nothing short of fierce. You, if you're in the pharmaceutical business, you don't want anybody to know what reagents you've ordered.
Yeah. This was voluntary. They were saying, what can we do to voluntarily show
I understand that, but the answer is, this is a bad idea. And one of the things that they may not have told you is that the trade secret element culture is extremely powerful throughout all of these businesses on all of these issues.
With that, I think we will end. I want to thank our panelists. Richard said that litigation is aggression. This panel was aggression, and very good aggression.
Yes, thank you.
Thank you, Troy.